For most people who are otherwise healthy, getting a cold is no big deal. The same is mostly true with the flu. Although there are no clear-cut guidelines that determine when you should see your doctor if you have the flu, I'll say this. If the flu is going around and you develop symptoms, it's best to see your doctor within a day or two, since that is when medications for the flu are most effective. Outside of that, you should use your judgment about seeing a doctor. So flu medications like Oseltamivir, aka Tamiflu, are effective only against influenza viruses and can reduce the severity of symptoms, shorten the time you're sick by 1 or 2 days, and make you less contagious. With that said, they don't cure the flu outright. So let's dive a little deeper about anti-influenza medications. When indicated, these antiviral flu medications should be given as soon as possible because of what I just mentioned. They're most likely to provide benefit within the first 48 hours of the illness. But it doesn't mean that after 48 hours, it's 100% ineffective. It's just that the sooner it's given, the more effective it is. And treatment shouldn't be delayed while awaiting diagnostic testing results. And patients who have a negative rapid antigen test for influenza, but in whom the clinical suspicion for influenza infection is high, should be treated because the relatively low sensitivity of the rapid flu test. So one major downside of giving these anti-flu medications to people who don't need them is the potential to breed resistant strains of influenza. So who's okay to skip out on getting treated? People who have uncomplicated influenza infection, meaning healthy people with mild infection who are outside the 48-hour window of symptoms. Okay, so there's two exceptions to that. One is if they live with someone who is at high risk for influenza complications. The other exception to that is if they're a healthcare provider. Patients with suspected or confirmed influenza in whom treatment is indicated should be treated with either oseltamivir, zanimivir, perimivir, or the new FDA-approved baloxavir. The gold standard has been the oral medication, oseltamivir, which is given in 75 milligram doses to be taken twice a day for a total of 5 days. If given within the first 48 hours of symptom onset, it's most likely to reduce the severity of illness, to reduce the duration of illness by 1 day on average, and it's going to make the person less contagious. But if given after the 48-hour window, it's minimally effective. Some studies have also shown that oseltamivir reduces illness severity and complication rates, hospital admissions, and length of hospitalization. If giving an oral medication is not an option, there's the IV perimivir, but it might not be as effective as oseltamivir. Inhaled zanimivir is not recommended for the treatment of hospitalized patients with influenza or those who would have difficulty using an inhaler. Baloxavir is a new single-dose oral medication that blocks influenza proliferation by inhibiting the initiation of mRNA synthesis. It's approved in the US for the treatment of acute, uncomplicated influenza for age 12 and up who've been symptomatic for less than 48 hours. It reduces the duration of illness by 1 day on average. Adverse effects of these medications that I just talked about, meaning the neuroamidase inhibitors, are typically mild if they do occur. Oseltamivir can cause nausea, vomiting. Zanimivir can cause bronchospasm and decline in respiratory function in patients with asthma and COPD. And perimivir can cause diarrhea. What about other cold and flu remedies? When it comes to adults, some prescription and non-prescription medications, aka over-the-counter meds, can help you feel a little better. In general, there isn't much difference between OTC cold remedies and those that are prescribed. One exception is a codeine-containing cough syrup, which can help people cough less and sleep better. The cold and flu products on the shelves of pharmacies more or less have the same drugs, just in different combinations. The decongestants found in most over-the-counter cold, flu, and allergy medicines can elevate blood pressure and interfere with medications used to treat high blood pressure. That's why, in general, people with heart disease or high blood pressure should avoid medications that contain pseudoephedrine or phenylephrine. These drugs work by constricting blood vessels in the nose and sinuses, which improves congestion. But these drugs also constrict the arteries throughout the body, causing the blood pressure to climb. Another drug, oxymetazoline, which is the active drug in Afrin, does a great job of opening the nasal passageways. But the downside is that it's notorious for causing worsening rebound congestion, aka rhinitis medicamentosa. That's why it's especially important that you don't use it for more than 2 to 3 days. With children, these cough and cold medicines have been shown to be ineffective and can have serious side effects, so check with your pediatrician. So things you can do to help with cold and flu symptoms include getting rest, drinking fluids if you're not too nauseated. For a sore throat, you can gargle warm salt water or use throat sprays or lozenges. Use petroleum jelly on your nose if it becomes raw from wiping it with tissues. You can sit in a steam-filled room to temporarily decrease congestion, or you can use vaporizers and humidifiers. Herbs and supplements for the common cold. It's hard to talk about most herbs and supplements with absolute certainty because most haven't been well studied for effectiveness, side effects, drug interactions, and appropriate dosage. Also, the FDA doesn't strictly regulate how herbs and supplements are made. So there are no guarantees in terms of strength, purity, safety, and how they affect the levels of other medications in your system. Some herbs and supplements commonly taken for cold and flu symptoms include vitamin C, echinacea, and zinc. Vitamin C has been taken with the hopes that it prevents getting the cold and or it's going to help with cold symptoms, but really this is more folklore than reality. There have been tons of studies on vitamin C, and most of them have shown little to no benefit to taking vitamin C for this purpose. Some of the studies even looked at taking huge doses, up to 8,000 milligrams, which the studies initially showed a little benefit, but then subsequent studies didn't show benefit. So as of now, there's not enough evidence to warrant taking vitamin C to either prevent or to help with the symptoms of cold. In the past, echinacea has been used to help with cold symptoms, and initial studies suggested that taking it when cold symptoms first begin reduces the duration and severity of symptoms. However, these studies were low quality, and subsequent higher quality studies did not find any benefit. Zinc may or may not help. So far, the studies on zinc have not been conclusive, so additional research is needed to determine whether zinc actually has an effect on colds. So that's all I got for cold and flu. Hope you enjoyed the video. If you did enjoy it, give this video a like, and I'll catch you in the next one.